We make about 45 million pounds of chips in a quarter. That equates to about 200 million pounds of potatoes, which is quite a few. What's interesting with M&T is they're a small town bank, and as we've grown, they've also grown with us. They've got the resources that you would need in order to go big, but they also have that friendly local community feel so that it makes it seem easier than it probably is.
Good evening. Welcome to the Candidates Forum presented by the League of Women Voters. We are in partnership tonight with Una Voz, Una Voto, One Voice, One Vote, and I'm Judith Cranes. I'm a member of the League. This program is in English on cable channels for BCTV and is in Spanish on Comcast 99 and BCTV's YouTube channel. So if you'd like to watch in Spanish, tune in there. Our candidates tonight are running for the Board of County Commissioners. Now, this board is the chief governing board of Berks County. They perform both the legislative and executive functions of county government. They serve four-year terms. The position pays $90,260 annually, and the board chair receives $92,990 annually. In the municipal general election on Tuesday, November 5th, you will be voting for two of these candidates. The top three vote-getters will be elected. Now, this is what commissioners do. They serve on the salary, prison, retirement, and election boards. They manage county finances and county property. They appoint a board to assess the real property in the county and are responsible for the county's annual budget, the annual tax rates, and they authorize all expenditures. They supervise elections, provide for the care of prisoners, and maintain county roads and county buildings. They oversee the county's technology and hire and fire county employees. And tonight, we're going to begin with an opening statement that allows each candidate to introduce themselves. The League has several questions we would like to ask, and we invite questions from our home viewers. Questions may be in English or Spanish. They should be relevant to the position of county commissioner, and all the candidates will answer all the questions. We will vary who speaks first on each question, and we ask the candidates to limit their answers to 1 minute so we can cover more questions. At the end of the program, we will allow 1 minute for each candidate to make a closing statement. Now, before we begin our introductions, I should note that the opinions expressed by the candidates do not necessarily represent the views or policies of the League of Women Voters, Una Voz, Un Voto, or BCTV. So let's meet the candidates. We have Christian Leinbach, Michael Rivero, Kevin Barnhart,
good evening,
and Donna Reed. So, Mr. Leinbach, we should call you Christian. Would you make the first opening statement?
Thank you very much, Judith. Thank you to the League of Women Voters of Berks County for hosting this candidates forum. I also want to note that this is being hosted on the anniversary of 9/11, and of course we remember all of the first responders, the public citizens that responded courageously to that event, and especially to those that gave their lives. I love the work I do as a county commissioner. I love the variety of work. I love the people that I work with in county government and the people that I serve. But one of the things that I've learned over the years, when I first ran, I was kind of led to believe that county government is just a stepping stone to higher office. I've come to the conclusion that county government is the higher office. It's the level of government that still works. I'm thrilled to be part of Berks County government. We have we're in a strong position, and hopefully tonight we'll talk about some of the great things that Berks County is doing. Thank you.
Thank you. Michael.
Yes, thank you, Judith, and thank you to the League of Women Voters for having us here tonight. And I also want to thank those of you that are at your homes watching us tonight, because if you're watching us tonight, it means that you are interested in Berks County and its future. And I want to congratulate you for that. And I'm running because I am also interested in Berks County and its future and making sure that Berks County is moving forward and that we can have a high quality of life for all Berks Countyans, and not just for us now, but for our children and our grandchildren as well. And there's different ways that we're going to be able to reach that goal. First of all, we need to focus on economic development, job creation, and workforce development. We also need to focus on spending, being responsible spenders, and we also need to make sure that taxes are being kept low. That way we can help the economy here in Berks County grow, and we can have a healthy lifestyle for all Berks Countyans, and we can also invite people to come and move here because they feel that Berks County is a great place to live and to work and to raise a family. I look forward to speaking more with you throughout the show. Thank you.
Thank you. And now let us go to Kevin for your statement. Thank you.
Thank you, Judith, and thank you to the League of Women Voters and BCTV for hosting this forum. It's a unique opportunity for the candidates to get together, discuss county-related topics, and to identify areas of agreement as well as disagreement. I believe my 12 years as a commissioner, as a minority member, as well as vice chair, speaks volumes for my ability to listen and understand diverse points of view and to govern with integrity. Every 4 years, the voters can review our progress and determine if we should be granted another term. I firmly believe that I've been extremely effective as your county commissioner, and I look forward to serving the people of Berks County, and I look forward to tonight's questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin. And now let's go to Donna Reed. Donna.
Thank you, Judith. Thanks to the League. Thanks to BCTV. My name's Donna Reed. I know you and you know me. For the first half of my working life, I spent my time as a working journalist covering government, covering the people of Berks County. The contacts I was able to make, the one-on-one interactions, being able to tell the stories of this terrific county have helped me immeasurably as I've gone through my different capacities post-Reading Eagle. I briefly worked at the Berks County Chamber of Commerce as their communications manager. I worked in private industry, and I retired as a working journalist in Lancaster County. All that time, covering government was a part of what I did, part of what I directed. Transparency is so important. It is important for everyone to know what is going on, unfiltered, to know how government works, to know how we all react to the issues at hand. I've seen that in City Council. We've been very transparent there, and I hope to do the same as a county commissioner.
Thank you, Donna. We're ready for our first question, but we also invite home viewer questions. The number to reach us is 610-378-0426. So our first question, we start out with Michael. What do you feel are the three biggest issues that county government will face in the next 4 years, and how do you think those issues should be handled? And if it's two, that's okay.
Okay.
Two, three, whatever.
Well, there's three big issues, at least from my point of view, that are important for county government so that we can move the county forward. One is economic development. How are we going to attract businesses to the county? How are we going to maintain businesses in the county? And how are we going to create jobs, and not only any job, but family-sustaining jobs? So that's one issue. The next issue is spending. We need to make sure that we can keep spending responsible, and we need to make sure that taxes are kept as low as possible as well. And that so that there's more money out there for people to be able to spend. The third issue that we have to look at, and although it's not something that the county commissioners have any control over, but we need to work with the state legislator to try to eliminate school property taxes. And I'm also in agreement that there be legislation passed that would allow the county to eliminate the county property taxes as well and be able to generate revenue from another source.
Thank you. We'll continue with that question. Kevin.
Thank you, Judith. The one issue that never goes away is the constraints of the county budget. As the county tax base goes, so goes the budget. We have many pressing issues. One in particular is the ongoing pension issue with the county. As the market changes, so does the required contribution to our pension. Our budget is the number one functional role of the county commissioners. We meet every Thursday for budget operations meetings, and we manage a $415 million budget. So that's, for me, number one. Number two is the jail and the increasing cost of the jail, as well as the perception that it should be run by a private operator. I'm totally opposed to that. And also, we do need to seriously look at rebuilding the existing jail into something more modern to provide adequate space for our burgeoning mental health and folks with a lot of medical health issues. The jail was built in 1933 and 1993. It's way beyond its useful life. And lastly, to keep the nursing home in public hands, that is a priority moving forward.
Thank you. Donna.
Okay. I think there's some degree of agreement here. Certainly, fiscal responsibility is critical. I know that having served on City Council during the Act 47 process, it is sometimes difficult to tighten one's belt, but it has to be done. I think there's been a lot of good work that's been done in the county. It certainly can be better. Anything can be better. Finding a way to raise some revenues is important. I've always been one to hold back on any kind of tax increases, because I do believe, you know, there's probably an alternative to property taxes, but right now we're not seeing it. But it's something to examine to see what other kind of revenue the county can produce without being onerous to property owners. Long-range economic development planning that stresses the urban core and protects the farmland, that goes in tandem, that goes hand in hand. Respecting our history, we've recently seen our history really disrespected over in Burn Township. I hope that doesn't happen again. And keeping things public, long-term planning to keep behind public, long-term ability to build a new prison that is needed, unfortunately, but also alternatives to treatment.
Thank you very much. Christian.
I think job number one for county government is the budget and fiscal responsibility. If we don't take care of our fiscal house and don't keep things in order, at some point it will drive everything that we do. Beyond continuing that good focus, I think there are two major issues. They were both referenced by my colleague, Commissioner Barnhart. Number one, the jail. We've done the studies. We understand that the 1933 and 1993 jail cannot survive as a long-term jail for the county. And I believe the first major decision this new board is going to face is building a new jail. I have also strongly opposed any privatization of the jail. This is a core responsibility of government. Number two is the Berkshine. We've bought time through the support of UFCW and SEIU, but in roughly 2022, our CFO is telling us that we will start losing money again. We have to address that shortfall with the legislature.
Thank you. We're going to go quickly to a home viewer question. And the question, this is from Ernest, and I don't have where he's from.
Reading.
From Reading, okay. What do the candidates feel about the contract between the city and between the county and the city of Reading, which has been at $900,000? What do you feel the increase should be, since there hasn't been one for the past few years?
And this is regarding the library.
This is regarding the library. Thank you, because I wasn't clear on that from the questions. So we begin with Kevin.
So just a bit of history. In 1999, the Board of Commissioners at that time entered into an agreement to provide $900,000 for what is the district center, the Reading Public Library, which provides a lot of service to the member libraries of the system. The $900,000 has remained that same number since 1999. I've advocated this year that we should seriously look at increasing that number by 2% year over year to start to provide some additional revenue. When you look at inflationary trends over the years, that number should be much higher than that. And part of the agreement does say that on an annual basis, the county should look at its budget, whether they can increase based on inflation those needs. Libraries are integral to our county, our community. They're great learning centers, they're great community centers. Our county in particular provides a large amount, about $3.4 million to the library system, one of the best in the Commonwealth. very proud of what the county does, but I still think we can do more to keep these libraries as assets as they are.
Thank you very much. Donna?
The city has tried in, as much as it can to add monies to the library. We were responsible for the buildings, things like that. But certainly from the county standpoint, it is an investment in not just our youth, but in our adults who use the libraries for so many things. They aren't just to take books out anymore, and they're not just for the fun of taking DVDs out. They are critical points of reference for people who are not connected to the internet, to go there, to do job searches, to get education, to be connected to families perhaps who are not close by. Libraries really are the community centers and are the heartbeat of a county and city. And we do have good ones here. We do have a good library system here. Funding that, increasing appropriately those funds is important because it's not just making a physical library better or more attractive or those kind of things. It is investing in our people and making sure that everyone has the opportunities that 200 years ago, 250 years ago, our forebears saw the importance of libraries, and we should continue with that tradition and fund them adequately.
Thank you. Christian.
Thank you. In the spring at the League of Women Voters Forum at the Why Missing Library, I was asked a similar question, and I made the commitment then, and we are discussing now as part of our budget process, a 2% increase to the Berks County Library budget. How that's allocated is yet to be determined, but I recognize that something needs to be done. There's an additional challenge, though, that hasn't been referenced, and that is that in the 12 years I've been in office, early on, the city of Reading cut its contribution to the Reading Public Library. The one thing that we can say about the county is the county has never cut its contribution to the library system or to the city of Reading. And in fact, when we eliminated the bookmobile and the bookosaurus, we kept the money in the budget. We didn't take that money, that savings, and put it in our general fund. So I'm committed to doing something. We have to determine what we can come to an agreement on as commissioners for the 2020 budget.
Thank you. I guess we are ready now for the next. Yep. Oh, I'm sorry, Michael.
Michael.
They're supposed to correct me when I mess up. It's fine. It's Michael.
Yes, I agree. The libraries are extremely important, not only in the city, but throughout the county as well. It gives access to people to the internet, to information that they may not be able to access elsewhere. So it's extremely important that we maintain and that we can support the libraries, again, not only in the city, but throughout the county as well. So definitely be in favor of looking at what can be done budgetarily to be able to continue the support and increase the support to counties as possible to be able to keep the libraries alive and to be able to help them continue to move forward and support the communities that they serve in. I had the opportunity of visiting the Reading Library here about 3-4 weeks ago and had some good conversations there. And I was very impressed by the services that they provide, the amount of people that they were there, how they work with children, with adults, with all different types of communities. So definitely libraries are something that we need to work to continue to keep alive and to be able to, that they be able to provide the services that the communities they serve need.
Thank you. And now we're ready for our next home viewer question. This is from Chad Heiser of Why I'm Missing. And he would like to know, do you believe Berks County is worse off today than it was 4 years ago? And this one starts with Kevin.
I thought I answered the first one.
Then it does. It starts with Donna. Okay. I am getting confused.
I think Berks is a terrific place. Are we worse off? No, I don't think we are. Do we face the challenges many people do? Yes, of course. We're in the Rust Belt area of the nation, of Pennsylvania. We have had economic development issues in the city that I think will change after January 1st, and I'm happy for that. But in the county, I think we can do more. We can do more to attract tourism. We can do more to attract jobs and companies. I think there's been some good things happening out in my native Muhlenberg with the new plastic recycling plant, the jobs coming there. We need more emphasis on the city and the urban core, not just the city, but the urban core and our small towns and villages to create jobs and economic development, walk to places there, and that goes hand in hand with keeping our farmlands pristine. What I think is worse is the terrible speculatively built warehouses in our upper part of the county and Hamburg area, which have taken over beautiful farmland, and many have been built in speculation. That may make Berks a little worse.
Thank you. Christian.
Well, I think there's two answers to this question. Number one, absolutely, we are doing better than we did 4 years ago. But I'm also a believer that you never can just sit back and say, we're where we need to be. We have to always be working to improve. That's one reason Michael Rivera and I have gone with the theme of together making Berks and Reading even better. But I think the proof is in the AAA plus stable outlook bond rating the county received in March. We're one of only five counties in the Commonwealth that have the highest rating possible, and Moody's, that gave us the bond rating, told us there were two reasons we got that upgrade. Number one, that we have a history of paying down and lowering our debt. That's fiscal responsibility. But number two, the growth in commercial and industrial tax base. We know this year, in fact, last month, we have a record number of jobs in the two highest growth areas, 1,100 new manufacturing jobs year over year, and nearly 800 healthcare jobs year over year. We're in great shape, but we always need to strive to be better.
Thank you. Michael.
I believe the county is in a better position than it was 4 years ago. If we look right now, Drexel is building in the West Reading Wyomissing area. There's a lot of development going on, new businesses coming into the area. So the county is moving forward, and that's great. But we can say, well, you know what? We're in a better position than we were 4 years ago, so we're going to take it easy now, and we're just going to coast along. Because once you stop trying to move forward, once you stop trying to get better, what happens is other counties are doing the same thing. They want to grow, they want to get better. And if we're not working better than them, if we're not doing things better than them, they're just going to pass us right by. So although we are in a good position right now, we need to make sure that we keep on working hard, that we keep on pushing Berks County forward, so that when we're asked this question in 4 years from now, we're able to say, you know what, 4 years ago, we were in a worse position, but 4 years ahead now, we are in a better position because we are able to work hard and accomplish our goals.
Thank you. Let's turn to Kevin.
Thank you. Yes, we are better off than we were 4 years ago, and the next 4 years will be even better. We have a HEIM that's under county control for at least the next 5 years and many more to come. We've had a tremendous job growth in the last 4 years. I was in a meeting this morning with the representatives of Berks Park 222, trying to settle that with DEP and PennDOT to get that project moving along to create over 200 jobs in Muhlenberg Township. We have the Stepping Up Initiative, which is we are an innovator county, one of only 13 in the United States, to really deal with diverting mental health folks out of the criminal justice system. We have consolidated Red Rose and BARDA, Lancaster and Reading's mass transit agencies, saving $2.5 million in local tax dollars, restoring Sunday service, and improving routes. And we've also created the Opioids Coalition. We peaked at about 120 deaths about 3 years ago. We're not exactly claiming success, but we're down below 90 in the prior year. So we are making inroads with stigma reduction and other things with Opioids Task Force. Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to come back to a League of Women Voters question. Next year is the U.S. Census. How can county government help assure an accurate count? And would you be willing to commit some county resources to that effort? And we're starting this time with Christian.
Yes. The answer is yes, and we have. We stepped up to the plate. Commissioner Barnhart and I have both been very vocal in the need to have a full count. I want to credit Commissioner Barnhart for really leading the charge from the Board of Commissioners. We had estimated 16,000 undercount in the last census, which would have been 2010. And when you look at that and the average federal dollars, CDBG money, HUD money, and a number of other areas that are allocated based on that, even transportation dollars, it is critical that we get a full count. Not having a full count costs taxpayers millions of dollars. And so we've made that commitment, I believe, and Kevin, you can correct me, I think we put an additional $50,000.
We have a total budget of $140,000.
$140,000, and I will tell you, I've met many counties in Pennsylvania and across the country that are doing it with little or nothing. We have other partners that also have stepped up with us, and we appreciate that, but the county has stepped up.
Thank you. Michael.
Yeah, I agree. It's extremely important that the county put its resources and work together, partner with other organizations and with the federal government to make sure that we get the most exact count as possible. As Christian had mentioned, every person that is not counted, that's money that is kept away from the county, which can help with programs and different resources for the county. So we need to make sure that we get an exact count. We need to make sure that we're out there working. And apart from the county putting money out, it's also important that the county can coordinate and work with agencies, especially agencies that work with minority populations. Because for the most part, it's those minority populations that don't get counted because they're afraid. They're afraid to say that they're here without papers. They're afraid to say that they're here from another country or that their children are here for whatever reason. So we need to make sure that those organizations that are out there working with the minority population are telling them that it's important. And it's important for them and for the county to be able to answer the questions honestly and to be able to report them in the census.
Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you. As chair of the Census 2020 Committee, I want to commend those groups that pulled together the $140,000 budget. They are Berks Alliance, the Berks County Chamber, the City of Reading, the County and the County CDBG Office, as well as BB&T Bank have contributed mightily. It's the highest budget we've ever had,
yes.
Donna, from the prior two decades of counting. And a lot of the numbers were covered here, but one of the things that's really important is those 16,000 estimated undercount are predominantly in the 19601 area code and Maxatawny Township, which are students at Kutztown. And each person that's not counted counts for $2,100 in lost federal revenue times 10 years. The math is $340 million lost in our community. 132 different federal programs are driven by that actual census number. So it's very important. We are meeting on September 25th with the Reading School Board to impress upon them the value of bringing their resources to the table to communicate with the students and their parents to make sure everyone is counted. It's so vitally important.
Thank you. Donna.
Well, I think back in Census 2000, we set the table for this, and Berks County was leading force then. I was lucky enough to be the Census Complete Count Committee Coordinator back then. Our logo was Everyone Counts in Berks. That's still our logo. The work that we did back then, working with the Community Foundation, with the Center for Excellence in Local Government, the great John Kramer, Gary Crick, who represented the Census Bureau here in Berks County. Ironically, we still don't have a Bureau specialist here, which is amazing,
yes.
20 years later. But the efforts we were able to do, and our undercount was so minimal back in 2000 that we were recognized not only by the governor's office, but we also went nationally to talk to other small, mid-sized cities how to do this. We have to have everyone counted. Kevin's been great pulling everything together. The cities come on board, and it's critical the cities on board with our diverse population, and some of the points Michael made are very clear. People have to be guaranteed their privacy. There is no question about citizenship on this, but everyone has to be counted. Why would we want those funds to go elsewhere? We need them here in Berks County. We're working with governments, agencies, you name it, churches, synagogues, we're working with everybody. And we want that count to be good. We want those funds appropriately to come to Berks and help us out.
Thank you. I'm going to follow up with another league question. Following the census, new lines are drawn to determine our voting districts. In the past, gerrymandering, drawing the lines for political advantage, has divided Berks County into districts with most of their population in a neighboring county. Now, I do realize this is not controlled by county commissioners,
absolutely.
But commissioners do have some influence. So I want to know, do you think gerrymandering is fair? Who do you think should draw the lines? And will you advocate for more cohesive districts for Berks County? And we are starting with
me?
Michael.
Yep.
Yes.
Okay. That's a great question. I do believe gerrymandering is not fair. It's something that needs to be addressed. I looked at, there was one area that came up from the south, then came a little area up through southern Berks, and then it circled the city. And how they do that, I have no idea. But it's definitely something that needs to be dealt with. I think that the line should be drawn, and I understand it's not easy to do, but they should be drawn more fairly, more equitably. Maybe a third party or someone that's not involved in being elected in or out in the next term may be the best way to go about that. I have to look more into it. But I definitely do believe that gerrymandering is something that needs to be addressed, that needs to be taken seriously.
Thank you. Kevin.
Yes, I believe gerrymandering should go by the wayside. You can never take the politics out of it. I think we need to have a fair district representation. And I don't even know if an independent board would be the most impactful or effective way to do that. I believe we have such computer modeling anymore. We can predict so many things like the weather and things like that. We can go through an algorithm and determine how many voters per legislative district, congressional district, and model that and balance it out. I truly believe that. And I don't believe that having several different congressmen really gives you any more say-so in Washington. I think it dilutes it. And Judith, before we started, you said the last time you did this, Gus Yatron was our congressman. So at that point, everyone actually knew who our congressman was. So I think we need to go back to those days and strongly advocate. We have nearly 500,000 people in Berks County. I think we need representation that's strong for Berks County.
Thank you. Donna.
Well, gerrymandering is pathetic. Let's just get that right out there. When I first joined City Council in 2002, my little council district was divided among congressional districts. And I actually had to fight with the one congressman who had a little office in City Hall that he truly represented the Riverside area of the district. That's how bad gerrymandering can get. In a city of, with the decennial census, you always have the redistricting, the reconfiguration. In the past, appropriately, it should be done compactly. Am I done? I'm sorry. Should be done compactly, and it should not be Fritztown Road being the dividing line. I mean, look at Michael and me. We live, what, half a mile apart, mm-hmm. a mile apart? We're two different congressional districts. The city of Reading did redistricting with our councilmanic districts. We had an apolitical, bipartisan, nonpartisan, whatever you want to call it, appointed commission that did it. It didn't dramatically change the constituency of the districts. I see Kevin's point about the algorithms and computers. Computers can get hacked. Computers can have problems. I think a combination of data and apolitical citizens looking at this is the right answer, and I hope that's something we can see on a state level.
Thank you.
Well, you can't look at the prior congressional map and not conclude that there's a problem with the map. And I think what people miss is, when did this happen? What caused the change? And if you go back to prior to 1970, the rule on drawing congressional and state legislative maps was that they had to be compact and contiguous. In the 1967 Constitutional Convention, an additional rule was added, and that was to guarantee equality of population district to district. That has created a problem. In the 67 convention, they said it's just an additional piece. But if you look at every 10 years since then, the maps got wider, less contiguous, and became a serious problem. The population issue has to be addressed, and we need to get back to the day that says compact and contiguous, and when you do that, Berks County is in one congressional district.
Let's hope. Hence the census.
Hence the census, yes. I would like to remind our voters that the election is Tuesday, November 5th. The polls are open from 7 in the morning until 8 at night. And if you are not yet registered to vote, you have until October 7th to register. And if you need more information on this, go online to vote411. Now, we do have some home viewer questions, and I will again invite our home viewers to call in. Our number is 610-378-0426. Now, Judy from Burnville wants to know what you will do to continue to grow the economy regarding jobs. And she also wants to know, what are you doing to attract full-time, good-paying jobs, full-benefit jobs? And we start with Kevin.
Well, I've been at the forefront of supporting the greater Reading Chamber Alliance and GREP with $500,000 a year to provide marketing promotional opportunities to attract good paying jobs to Berks County. I think we've been highly successful. Over the prior 12 years, we have created many, many jobs, billions of dollars in assessed value. We continue to strive that way. We are actually reaching a point where we are running out of qualified employees, and our workforce investment director, Dan Fogarty, says it best, it's a great tsunami. We have folks retiring out of the trades. We have folks retiring out with really diversified skill sets. We need to further impact our educational component. We have to get back to the trade schools and the vocational technical schools, and really to understand that we need tradesmen, electricians, carpenters, plumbers, folks like that, machinists, welders. Places like East Penn Manufacturing are short 300 employees. We have again attracted a lot of good paying jobs that are coming online in Muhlenberg Township, with at least three developments taking place there. These jobs are anywhere from $15 to $20 an hour.
Thank you. Donna.
Well, I think there's always the importance of public-private partnerships. So Kevin's touched on a lot of good things there. Certainly, things have improved over the years with the gathering together of the economic development agencies. I remain concerned about some of the policies and some of the problems, I think, that are the result of really not looking at the county as a whole, looking at Reading and Berks County. I think there has been a hesitancy to concentrate in the urban core. I'm glad to see Muhlenberg's getting some attention. I think there's a far bigger need for the brownfields areas to be developed and for emphasis to be placed on them so people have walk-to-work jobs. I worry that a number of the jobs that are created aren't well-paying. We know some of the manufacturing ones certainly are, but there's also a lot of service jobs out there that aren't real well-paying, that aren't family-sustaining. So I think it's a combination of public-private partnerships, working with our educational institutions for the trades, for the skills, and encouraging people to see Berks County as a destination, a working destination, and a place for good jobs. Going in tandem with that, of course, is our transportation concerns that we have.
Thank you. That's coming up in my next question.
Okay. segue.
Then we're ready for Christian.
I want to highlight, we do have, as Kevin said, some great partners. The Chamber Alliance has been a strong advocate for economic growth, and in particular sectors, looking at small business, looking at manufacturing, and looking at healthcare. When you look at Berks County, our two largest job areas by far are manufacturing, over 32,000 jobs, healthcare, over 28,000 jobs. With the recent announcement and groundbreaking of Drexel University College of Medicine and Tower Health Medical School, that is a game changer. I believe it's very likely that in the next 3 to 5 years, the healthcare jobs will outstrip the manufacturing. But in both cases, that is where our growth is occurring. And these are well-paying, full benefit, full-time jobs. I believe we are focusing in the right areas. We need to continue that focus to grow those kinds of jobs for Berks Countyans.
Thank you. Then we're ready for our next home viewer. No, we're not. We didn't get Michael. Thank you. I'm confused by where my paperclip is.
That's okay.
You should have little, like,
I'm confused too.
You should have little, like, colored panels or something.
Well, I knew you'd help keep me on track. It's a cooperative venture. Michael.
Something that's important to be able to grow jobs is not only attract companies to the area, but we also need to make sure that we're working with companies that are already in the area. Mm-hmm. They're here, they believe in Berks County, they're invested in Berks County, they've been here for years. So we need to make sure that they're able to grow, and to be able to grow many times, especially in advanced manufacturing in the healthcare field, we need to make sure that we have an educated workforce. If a company's poised to grow and they don't have the workforce that they need, rather than growing here, they're going to go elsewhere to grow. So we need to make sure that we're educating our students, we're educating our youth. And the reality is, college is not necessarily the right path for every kid. We have to look at the youth. What is a career for them? Is it in advanced manufacturing? Is it in welding? Is it in the trades, which are short of employees right now because no one wants to study that? Mm-hmm. So that's extremely important to be able to grow our local economy, to make sure that the companies that are here now and that those that are going to come into the area know that there's an educated and a well-prepared workforce that they can hire to be able to work in those companies.
Thank you. We're going to do that transportation question, and then we have two home viewers. We will get to you. Please be patient. We've all seen a lot of road and bridge construction projects lately. You can hardly turn down a street and not run into something. But I'm questioning whether that is sufficient to meet the transportation needs of the county. So what do you see as critical to meet the county's transportation needs? And is there anything you can do as a commissioner to help make that happen? And I guess we're starting with... Who are we starting with? Now I'm lost again. Is it Kevin?
If he was last, it would be Kevin.
Okay, then I'll take it. I have been a transportation advocate all the time. I've been a county commissioner. Obviously, I'm chair of both BARTA and South Central Transit Authority, as well as advocating with ReadingBridges.net as a public-private partnership with the chamber to help us navigate the reconstruction of both Buttonwood Street, the Penn Street Bridge, and ultimately 422 bypass. But to get to your comment, we instituted a creative method of a $5 registration fee. A number of years ago was an alternate for a county to place a $5 fee. We've already raised an average of $1.9 million a year. We're on our fourth replacement bridge in Berks County. Those monies are supplemented by state and federal money. We found out recently that the monies that were projected to come into Berks County over the next 10 years will be cut by almost $160 million. That money is being reallocated to the interstate roadway system, the national highway system here in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. It's shifting priorities. I think there's a great amount of construction going on. It may be an inconvenience, but quite honestly, most of this is 30 years behind where it should have been. With the lack of resolve from the state and even the county government, we had the worst bridges in the county. So we're playing catch up right now.
Okay.
Donna.
Okay. I think the one of the real challenges we're looking at is what Kevin alluded to is the potential cutbacks that we're seeing facing us, $160 million, probably more than that. That's going to impact particularly what's really critically important in all of Berks County is the reconstruction, the $650 million projected reconstruction of the West Shore Bypass. This is a county that depends on cars. It's not necessarily great, but it's what it is. And anyone who travels that West Shore on a daily basis knows the challenges of it. That has to be improved. The Warren Street Bypass, Route 12 is congested, 422 is congested. It is a difficult situation around the urban core. The reallocation of the monies that are going to the interstate highway system, of course, I-78 needs work. I was just on that again the other day. I'm glad I don't have to travel that a lot. Mm-hmm. But that's critical, of course, to commerce in Berks County. But more important is we have to look back and we have to look forward to putting emphasis on mass transport, getting a return of bus lines, trying to find a way, some limited passenger air, and also the train. We have to work with our neighboring municipalities and try to get that train back with federal and state contributions.
Thank you. Christian.
I sat in a planning commission meeting late this afternoon, and the discussion was transportation priorities and the funding cut. The funding cut is a major issue. We're going to need that addressed by both the state and the federal legislators. But I want to assure folks, the I-78 project, which is the largest interstate project undertaken in Pennsylvania, and that's largely Hamburg East, is fully funded. That is moving forward. Mm-hmm. 222, the immediate projects are moving forward. But the ultimate completion to the Lehigh Valley line is likely going to be delayed. The West Shore Bypass is probably going to have to be broken up into multiple parts. I think it was going to have to be broken up anyhow. but that is going to be delayed. I wouldn't be surprised if it's 20 years before that is able to be completed. Finally, I believe passenger rail service must be revisited. Number one, King of Prussia is building a station, Phoenixville's doing a study, and Drexel University has asked for train passenger rail service from Philly to Wyomissing.
Thank you. Michael.
I think one of the great things about Berks County and why many businesses are coming to this area is because we're located within a two-hour drive to many major cities, Philadelphia, New York, Washington, D.C. So we're centrally located. But we need to make sure that we have access to those areas. One of the main concerns is 222 between here and Allentown. If you look at Allentown from Allentown to New York, there's easy access there, and Allentown has been growing because of that. So we need to make sure that we're able to connect from here to Allentown, that we're able to connect from here to King of Prussia, and to make it easy for people to be able to access Berks County and from Berks County, access these major cities as well. So I think we need to look at that and see what we need to do infrastructure-wise, and it may be mass transit. I believe also we need to revisit and look at the possibility of passenger rail from here to King of Prussia to be able to connect us from to Philadelphia. That will not only allow us to get down to Philadelphia area, but it will allow also the people from the Philadelphia area to come up into this area. So we need to revisit and make sure that as at Berks County, we're able to easily connect with the major cities that surround us so that our economy can continue to grow.
Thank you. We have several home viewer questions left, so I'm going to ask you to try to answer this next one in 45 seconds.
Okay.
And the question is, what's the most important private or public accomplishment you want to share with the public? And Donna, we start with you.
I would say working with county and city, the Antietam Lake preservation. That was a hard thing to come by. The county has a beautiful park system. Antietam Lake was really a contentious subject back in the early 2000s, but working with that then Board County of Commissioners and working with Mayor McMahon and two of my council colleagues, to see that enhanced with the county's efforts, to see it be a place of respite for people and a place of enjoyment, that gives me a lot of joy and a lot of satisfaction to know that that's what public service is about.
Thank you. Christian.
I would have to say it revolves around the bond rating, not just the most recent one, but if you look at the last 12 years, we had an increase in our bond rating in 2008, and again in 2009 in the midst of the Great Recession. And we continued to focus on fiscal responsibility. Because of that, we've been able to do the things that are important in our county that have put us in a position where we have the strongest local economy that I ever remember seeing. It's demonstrated by the number of jobs. It's demonstrated by the growing commercial and industrial tax base. And we have a vision among our economic partners like I've never seen before. I believe what's happening right now in West Reading and Wyomissing is pushing to the city of Reading. And I believe come January, the city of Reading will be ready for that economic development.
Thank you. Michael.
I'm very proud and excited about a project that's going on right now in the city of Reading, and it's a development which of what used to be the Old City Garage. It's on the corner of 4th and Elm Street in Reading. The building sat there vacant for many, many years now. Maybe you've read about it in the news or saw it on TV, but it's an $8.5 million project in which there's going to be a supermarket with a restaurant there, a wholesaler, and a small manufacturing component to it as well. It's going to take the whole building. The project is going to create about 150 jobs in the area, but it's not only going to create jobs, it's going to also fill a need, which there's a fresh fruit and fresh meat desert in that part of the city. So it's a great project. Again, $8.5 million coming to the city for development, creating jobs, and jobs for people that live in that area and maybe can't get a job elsewhere because they don't have a car or don't know how to drive. So it's an opportunity for them to get a job and work and redevelop that area in the city.
Thank you. Kevin.
As a board, I think that's our financial strength and stability as a county, but on a personal level, spent over 2 years creating a council of governments called the Mount Penn Preserve, bringing together Alsace Township, Lower Alsace Township, Mount Penn Borough, the City of Reading, the County of Berks, to preserve and promote and market this 2,100-acre asset we have, we call the Mount Penn Preserve. It took a lot of arm twisting, a lot of meetings, night meetings and things like that, to really pull this together, because when you sit in a position like we have, you really look at the day-to-day, but you also look at what are we leaving as a legacy for the future for our children and our grandchildren. And I think with the efforts of including Donna, who's on the board as well, looking at that as a real asset for tourism, but also to preserve it and keep it in, as it is so magnificent right now.
Thank you. We have a question from David in Kumru, and I'm going to give it a quick answer, because it's, why do we have all the other officers of the county, for example, the clerk of court?
Rural offices.
They are mandated by state law. They all have specific functions. By switching our government from the commissioner form to a home rule charter, we could eliminate that. We tried that, what, about 20 years ago, and it didn't succeed. But the league will be happy to provide you more information on that if you can go to our website. It's info at leagueofwomenlwv.org, and just leave your return email and we will get you more information. Because we have less than 5 minutes left, I'm going to ask for 30 seconds and no more on this last question. And that is from Gina in Reading, and she wants to know, how do you view the City of Reading in regards to Berks County? I think sometimes city residents may feel they are not, they're considered separate or different from the rest of the county. And we start with Christian.
I've been clear on this. The City of Reading is geographically central. It is the largest municipality in the county, and it provides us with an urban core. The greater Reading area is why we have four of the five colleges and the universities right here in this greater Reading region. It is an asset, and we need to treat it as such. I think we as county commissioners have tried to do that, and I'm looking forward to working with the new mayor so that we can have even a better relationship going forward.
Thank you. We need to be very quick because we have 4 minutes, and I think we may be doing away with our closing remarks. So, okay. Michael.
Well, I'll keep it simple. I believe that the city is an extremely important part of the county, and as a county commissioner, I would work closely with the mayor to be able to do everything that we can to help the city grow and thrive and be the important part of the county that it is.
24% of our residents live in Reading, so it's an obvious decision. I was born and raised in Reading, attended at schools and volunteered as a fireman. And right now, I don't have enough time to get into my housing strategy, but I've been working with David Hunter at the City of Reading about a real comprehensive housing structure, housing strategy that if I had more time, I would explain. Thank you.
Thank you. Donna.
City of Reading is my heart and my home. I chose to live here. I chose to raise my son here. My son is choosing to raise his son here. It is a wonderful city. It is a changing city. It is a vibrant city. But until the county accepts the fact or realizes that Reading is truly a part of Berks County and stops saying Reading and Berks County, says Greater Reading, that's starting to change. We have so much to offer, and I'm old enough to remember when the city supported the county. Now it is the time for us all to work together to restore the vibrancy of Reading to a different kind of vibrancy than what people remember. We look to the past and we treasure that past. But the future is so promising. Michael hit on the project at 4th and Elm. We're working through Act 47. We've worked with the county on MP3 and other projects. We are all in this together. And I am proud to call myself a resident of the City of Reading. I'm proud to call myself a Berks Countyan.
Thank you. We have 2 minutes, and I have a little piece to close at the end. So I'm going to give each of you 15 seconds to say your final words. Michael, you're first on this.
Yep. I want to thank everyone for watching us here tonight. I want to thank you for the opportunity, for me being able to be here and being at the general election on November 5th. I count on your vote. Please vote for Rivera Linebach on November 5th. And best luck to all of you.
Thank you. Kevin, you're next.
Again, I appreciate the opportunity. I lead with character and integrity, and I don't need on-the-job training, so I ask for your vote on Election Day, Tuesday, November 5th. And you want to learn more about me, experience matters, barnhart4berks.com. Thank you.
Thank you. And Donna.
Thanks again to everyone. Berks County, you know me, I know you. Google me, look me up, check me out, see what I've done over the years. I've stayed with the city at times when others might have left. I've devoted myself to public service in a second act of my working career. I'd like to help the county. I'd like to be an important part of moving this county forward. I think we're a terrific place to be. It's a wonderful life here in Berks County, and I ask for your support on November 5th.
Thank you. Christian.
Thank you very much to the League. You know me, and you know my record. It's very clear. And if you believe that fiscal responsibility matters, if you believe that jobs and the economy needs to be a focus of this Board of Commissioners going forward, I would ask you to vote for Michael Rivera and Christian Leinbach, Making Berks Better. And our website is makingberksbetter.com. Check it out for some more information. Thank you.
I want to thank our candidates. I thank our viewers for tuning in and asking questions. And I want to especially thank the staff of BCTV and Una Voz Un Voto for making this program available in Spanish and English. The race for commissioner is likely to be decided by a few thousand votes. The League of Women Voters urges you to be one of those votes. Thank you and good night.
Good night.
We make about 45 million pounds of chips in a quarter. That equates to about 200 million pounds of potatoes, which is quite a few. What's interesting with M&T is they're a small town bank, and as we've grown, they've also grown with us. They've got the resources that you would need in order to go big, but they also have that friendly local community feel so that it makes it seem easier than it probably is.